We're glad to welcome Joe Hurst, and I'll give the attention to him. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you. Well, I think you embellished my introduction a little bit, but that's okay. Creative license, that's good. I'm all for that. Well, I've always been artistic, even as a kid. Mom said when I was 2 years old, I would color myself to sleep in bed, and she'd have to fish the crayons out of my pillowcase. So she kind of figured I was going to be an artist when I grew up. And if she was right, as I got older, I continued expressing interest in art. And she's an art teacher, so she taught me different art mediums that she knows, like watercolor and acrylics and that kind of thing. And her favorite medium, which is chalk talk. And who here has seen a chalk talk before? Okay, a couple of you. Yeah. Well, it's a very old art. It originated in the 1800s. Street performers and comedians would use it to illustrate what they were talking about. And they would talk while they drew, obviously, hence the name. But as TV and radio came along, it kind of fell by the wayside. So there's very few who practice it today. My mother discovered this art from an old book, 100-year-old book that she found while she was cleaning closets at Bible school in Oklahoma. And she taught it to herself and applied it to her Sunday school lessons to help teach the kids, help keep them interested. And it worked very well. Before she knew it, she was doing it in churches all over Oklahoma, and when she got home, all over Lancaster, and the rest is history. So we have a bunch of different programs that we do, and the one I'm going to do today is called You Can Make a Difference. So I'll get the audio hooked up, you get the lights out, and we'll get started.
Thank you. God's word tells us in Jeremiah 29, verse 11, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Again in Psalms 139, verse 16, your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed, and in your book they were all written, the days fashioned for me, when as yet there was none of them. Written in heaven for every individual, God has a plan, a divine destiny, a purpose for us to fulfill. We were created with a plan and a purpose, yet many people go all the way through life, aimless and empty, never having discovered that purpose. The person without purpose is said to be like the ship without a rudder. They go about life from one circumstance to another, with no direction, no vision, no purpose. To them, life is pointless and empty. Very little, if anything, is accomplished in their lives. On the other hand, Bible history and modern-day history is rich and full of inspiring stories of ordinary folks who served an extraordinary God, allowing him to work in and through their lives, thus having a purpose and making a difference in their generation. Here is a look at a few of my favorite stories. I find the story of Queen Esther very inspiring. It is found in the Old Testament in the book of Esther. Esther is a woman characterized by her self-denial, tact, courage, and patriotism, of whom her foster father said, who knows but that you have come into royal position for such a time as this? For at this time, the Jewish people were in danger of total extinction. Esther showed self-denial and courage by going into the presence of the king, petitioning for her people, the Jews, knowing full well that it could have meant death according to royal law, for she had not been called by the king. With tact, she presented her petition. With courage, she exposed Haman and his wicked scheme before the king. With patriotism, she pleaded with the king to put an end to Haman's plans, which he had devised against the Jews. She pleaded that the order would be overruled, and so it was. She found favor with the king, and a new decree was made, and the Jews were protected. Much joy and celebration followed, and to this day it is commemorated by the Jews during the Feast of Purim. Had it not been for Esther, there might have been a different story to tell in future ages. Esther made a difference in the Hebrew nation. Then there's a story found in 2 Kings chapter 5 of a little unknown maid whose name the Bible does not mention. She worked in the household of the great general Naaman, commander of the army of Syria, a mighty man of valor, but he was a leper. Having come from the land of Israel, the little maid knew of the true and living God and of his willingness and ability to heal the sick. She said to her mistress, would that my Lord were with the prophet who's in Samaria, for he would heal him of his leprosy. The news was brought to Naaman, and he went to see Elisha, the prophet of God. And through a series of events, he was healed from the leprosy. And then Naaman declared, behold, now I know that there is no God in all the earth but in Israel. So, the little unknown maid, having evangelized the great general, aided Naaman in securing his health. Who knows but of the many people who have turned to the God of Israel through this event. The little maid spoke of God, and she made a difference. In recent history, yet another child made a difference during the time of a different kind of need. On September 13th of 2001, 8-year-old Dylan Coleman was riding in the car with his mom, listening to the radio, when the disc jockey announced that the station was auctioning off tickets to a famous singer's concert. The money would go to the American Red Cross to help the victims of September 11 attacks. Dylan wanted to help, so he used his mom's cell phone to call the radio station, offering to use the $60 in his savings account to bid on the tickets. Sorry, buddy, the DJ told him, but somebody already made a higher bid. That's okay, Dylan said. I want to give the money anyway. Dylan's unselfish gift caused the others at the station to want to help by adding some money to Dylan's gift so he would get the highest bid. Soon all the phone lines in the radio station were ringing. Many people and businesses called to give money, and everybody wanted it to go to the Dylan Fund. Before the day was over, almost $115,000 had been raised for the September 11 victims. to shoot baskets with the musicians. Dylan's story appeared in the local newspaper, which got Congressman Bob Gillette's attention. He mailed a letter to President George W. Bush explaining how Dylan's gift had inspired so many people to donate money for the September 11 victims. A few months later, President Bush sent Dylan a letter. Your story is a wonderful example of how one person can make a big difference, President Bush wrote. Dylan says he gave his money because he wanted to help the victims, and God always honors a willing giver. Dylan never expected to become a celebrity. He was just doing something he likes to do, and that is to help others. Between 1483 and 1546, we read of a German reformer whose faith and courage changed the world he lived in and still affects us today. Martin Luther was born in Eisleben, studied law at the University of Erfurt. 1512, he became a doctor of theology and professor of biblical studies at Wittenberg. While teaching there, he came to understand the nature of the righteousness of God. He rejected all theology based solely on tradition and emphasized personal understanding and experience of God's word, for we not being justified by our deeds, but by faith alone. Because of his stand, he faced much danger. For his own safety, he was seized and taken to Wartburg Castle. There, he devoted himself to translating the New Testament from Greek to German, so the Bible could be read by the common people. This resulted in a reformation, which was primarily a rediscovery of the gospel of God's saving work in Christ. Because of Martin Luther's bold stand of obedience to God's word, during his lifetime he saw a great spiritual awakening take place, and lasting social and political and economic changes followed the reformation. In this last story, the history of how one person was reached for Christ begins when in 1858, a Boston Sunday school teacher named Kimball began visiting one of his students at the shoe shop where he worked as a clerk. Eventually, he led him to Christ. The student's name was D.L. Moody. 21 years later, Moody, now an evangelist, Wilbur Chapman got saved. Chapman became active in the YMCA, where he met and discipled a former baseball player called Billy Sunday. Sunday became a great revivalist, and in one of his crusades in Charlotte, a group of businessmen came to Christ. A year later, they decided that their city needed another crusade, so they invited Mordecai Ham to be their speaker. Among the converts was a 16-year-old farm boy called Billy Graham. Billy Frank, as his mother called him, accepted Christ as personal savior. On his way home, no bell sounded, no signs flashed across the sky, but Billy felt a quiet peace. Before getting into bed that night, he got down on his knees for the first time and prayed, "Lord, I don't know what happened to me tonight. You know, and I thank you for the privilege." In his heart, a desire began to grow, a desire to share the gospel, and he prayed for opportunities. During high school, he shared his testimony while going door to door selling hairbrushes for the Fuller Brush Company. Later, he attended Florida's Bible Institute in Tampa. While there, he would row his canoe across a lake to an island to practice his sermons, the alligators and the birds being his only congregation. He preached these sermons at trailer parks and jails. As a young man, Billy Graham learned to hear and obey God's voice. Eventually, God led him to conduct crusades all over the United States and around the world. The Billy Graham Evangelistic Association had worked more than a year to coordinate the largest single evangelistic effort in the history of Christianity, the year 1995, the location San Juan, Puerto Rico. Dr. Graham's sermons were translated from 17 satellite pathways to 30 satellites across 29 time zones. The numbers after the event were staggering. 185 countries reached, messages heard in 117 languages, 3,000 mission locations involved, over 10 million seats occupied per night, over 500,000 prepared counselors, 1 billion people viewed the broadcast, another 3 million attended video missions at various sites. Spanning more than 80 years of ministry, the stories of changed lives through his preaching could not be contained by a room full of books. The preaching of the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ through Billy Graham made a huge difference in the 20th century. Jesus Christ is the author of Christianity and is by far the greatest figure in history. He made and continues to make the greatest difference in the world. God in Christ Jesus came to this earth in the form of human flesh to take upon himself the penalty of our sins by dying on the cross for us. Taking the punishment for sin that rightfully belonged to us, he presents to us the gift of salvation by virtue of the new birth, which is received by faith in him. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. Whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life." This eternal life that is received is not only the promise of life with God forever in heaven, but it is also a quality of life that we can experience by the presence and power of God's Holy Spirit in our lives here and now. And we can only make a difference to the extent that we allow him to make a difference in our lives. You need not be a king or a queen or a doctor of theology in order to make a difference. It's simply a matter of letting God be God in our lives. God has given us all spiritual assignments, and with those assignments comes the grace and the gifts of God to do it. So let's find and function in life in our individual calling and watch God make the difference. The many feelings of emptiness and lack of fulfillment that even Christians experience often comes because they are not doing what God has called them to do. Begin to make a difference now, first by giving your life to the Lord, by giving of your time and your talents and resources in the name of the Lord. you the desires of your heart. Commit your ways to the Lord, trust in Him, and He will do this. Embrace what God has put in your heart, and by faith, step confidently towards your heart's desire, and you too will make a difference.
Think my life in charity.
Free to come up and take a closer look at it then after the rest of the evening is finished. I'm going to leave the black lights and stuff like that. To capture the black light effect the best with the cameras, just turn the flash off. And if you need help with that, I can do that for a nickel per adjustment. I'm going to leave the picture with you guys. You're looking for me out where it goes and where to hang it and all that stuff. Over here, we have DVD recordings of several different chalk talks. We don't have the one you see here, but we do have a Christmas one, a Easter-themed one, and a patriotic-themed one, so we have a bunch of different ones there. And there's also a book series in Mother Rose, so feel free to take a look at those things after the rest of the evening is finished. Thank you again for having me.
Thank you, Joe. Wow, amazing. And my gosh, thanks for the gift. It's, it'll have a prominent place when we do what we pray we're going to do. And I want you to just take a moment and stare at that. Just take a good look. And I want you to capture the symbolism of it. Okay? We'll get out of the way here. And because it wasn't intentional, Joe and I didn't have a conversation, but it kind of fits in with some remarks that I could make. Got the symbols? They're not hard symbols, but they're right on the money symbols. there's an agenda I am to follow. I'm not going to follow it by the book, but I would like to, one of the exciting things about what we're doing is it involves all generations. All generations have a part in some of the things that we're trying to accomplish. So I'm going to ask, and if this is embarrassing for someone, just don't do it, okay? Those of you who are 90 years of age and older, could you stand? 90 years of age and older. Just sit down. Please. Very good. Thank you. Well, good, and of course, Jean Gimmel. Thank you. All right, now the groups will get bigger as we go down. 80 years of age and older. And again, if you don't want to admit to all this, then please. About that. Thank you. Okay, you know where we're going. 70 and between 70 and 80. Fantastic. Thank you. And now between 60 and 70. 60 and 70. Look at that part. Did you know at one time we were called the baby boomers? Okay, 50 to 60. A big crowd there, big crowd, thank you. And 40 to 50. A little bit smaller crowd, even though they're not admitting anything. 30 to 40. Splendid. Thank you. And 20 to 30.
Woo!
Yes! Wait a minute, check that driver's license. And let's see, now we're into the teenage years. 10 to 20. Yeah, admit it. Welcome there. Okay. And lastly, there are a couple here between 0 and 10. And there they are! All right. So why do we do that? Well, I think the exciting thing about this is that it does involve all generations. And I'll tell a little story tomorrow that Scott McKenzie told about a gentleman who was 90 years old who just took great joy in the fact that he was going to be able to build one more church even after he had already built, been a part of building three. And so I'll unpack that. But what we're about to do involves all generations and involves generations yet to be. And aren't we grateful for that kind of an opportunity? I'm going to introduce Jim Stein. Many of you know Jim. Jim has served as our campaign coordinator. He's had a lot of help. So I'm going to, once again, part of the celebration is to celebrate all the energy that so many put into this, and you're going to have that revealed to you momentarily. So, is it time now? Are they ready to go? Okay, yes, the children can go upstairs to, we're going to the nursery, which is right above us down at that end of the hallway, so you've got to go up two flights of steps and then one more half flight, and you'll get there. So they're going to make a picture of you that's going to look comical. Your mother is depending upon this. Okay? Good. Jim, thank you. Jim, I told him I was going to do this to him. He agreed to coordinate the campaign, and what he didn't reveal at the outset was that Donna, his wife, had been planning a trip to Italy. And so right in the middle of the campaign, he took off. So... he has done an amazing job, and before we acknowledge all the rest of the folks who've helped, let's acknowledge Jim. I can't even begin to tell him.
Well, Andre asked me to do this about 10 minutes before dinner started, so I hadn't planned to do this, but I was on a three-hour ride in the car today by myself, and I got to thinking a little bit about this church and this celebration tonight, and I started thinking about celebrations, and probably many of you can, you know, understand exactly where I'm coming from, because you probably have some of these same celebrations yourself. And if you think back, you know, one of the first celebrations perhaps was graduation from high school, and it was a big celebration, and that happens in the lives of most all of us or our families, and that's a great time. Probably more recently in the life of the church here was the confirmation class and the celebration and that was just an unbelievably great celebration that we had here. It was just amazing with that group of young people and the commitment that they are making to their Lord. And then, of course, for many of us, that wonderful celebration of marriage. And Jerry and Lois are getting real close to that celebration. And that celebration goes on every day. And I started thinking a little bit about this celebration tonight and how it might impact me. And you know, part of my celebration here is Donna and I joined the church probably about 7 or 8 years ago. I started singing in the choir. And I get to see most of you on Sunday mornings sitting out in the congregation. But that doesn't mean that I really got to know all of you. And it's not easy to come into a church and a church of this size and get to know everybody. And so one of the celebrations for me is the opportunity that I've had to just to get to know a number of people that I didn't know in that kind of a way in this church. And so it's just been a blessing to me to have this role and to be able to get to know so many of you. I guess when this whole thing started in the feasibility study and we got together and decided we needed to develop a campaign leadership team, Roger seems to want to heap accolades on me. I don't know exactly sure why, but the accolades belong to this group of people. And I would like everybody that's a part of the campaign leadership team to please stand right now. Those of you that are part of that team, and whatever role that you might play. We have about 8 different teams that these people represent. Please, they are the people that have been doing what you've seen. And if you could stay standing just for a second, they needed other people. And there's other people that have joined in this whole thing. And so if anybody has had any role whatsoever in this campaign, please stand right now and join our leadership team. Thank you. You can be seated, but What I have learned is the unbelievable people that are part of this church. And as a coordinator, I was willing to take on that responsibility, and partly because a celebration that I had personally myself about a year ago as I retired. And some of you have experienced that celebration as well. Tonight, we're here to celebrate the Holy Spirit working in this church. I mean, it's just amazing. You can almost feel it. And so this celebration, okay, you represent the celebration of what we're about to do. And God's going to do through us and with us. Just think of the amazing things that are going to occur here in this church, because God had a vision and he passed it on to us, and we're going to do something about it. And all the people that are going to benefit from this vision for years to come. It's just really amazing. So I look at this as a celebration. It truly is a celebration, and it's a celebration of us together as a family, a church family. So I just thank all those people that have done so much. It's just been an amazing, amazing group of people. And as a coordinator, I'm worried about, is this going to get done? Is this going to get done? I didn't have to worry at all. I mean, these people just, they were way ahead of everything. Just, if Scott McKenzie were here tonight, he would tell you about how we have just done amazingly as far as getting things done on time or ahead of time. And I would be remiss if I didn't add one other person here, and that's Tammy. What could you do without Tammy? What was I supposed to do, Roger? So anyway, thank you so much. For this has been a blessing to me, and I know it's going to be a blessing to the Lord as well. Thank you.
All of us working together has made this possible. And before very long, we're going to reveal a number to you. We're going to do that in terms of the Price is Right. Try to have a little fun with it. You can guess. And do you know when? Well, it used to be Bob Barker. Now it's Drew Carey, right? Drew Carey. And when they get somebody up there, they put the numbers up, and then they bring somebody up, and they're supposed to juggle the numbers until they get it right. And if they get it right, they get a new car. Well, you know, new cars here. But we do want to, as part of our celebration, acknowledge some pretty amazing things, I think, and I trust that you'll enjoy doing that. Now, if you happen to know the number, Tammy and a couple others of you, you're not allowed to participate. By the way, I don't think she really knows the number as of right now, but in a moment we're going to do that. I want to go back to the picture and just spend a brief moment. What do you see there? Just tell me what you see. What's the weather like? Yeah.
I'm not talking weather, but okay. That's an old tree with a lot of new growth.
An old tree with new growth on it. Very good. Very good. There's a ship. It looks like it's been through a lot, you know, beaten up maybe by waves and wind, and so you see that. What else do you see? Sunset. Yeah, it's sunset, but it's a kind of a sunset that happens when kind of a stormy sunset. But it's there. Noah's Ark right away, yeah. An angel at the very top? Uh-huh, how about that? I missed that, but, Yeah. Betty is a newly self-discovered artist, so now we'll expect you to give a chalk talk. You've got something new to work on now. Okay. Anything else you're seeing? Yes, Dave? Obviously, the beacon shining in such a way that it's directing this battered boat. Anything else?
I think the
The ship kind of looks like an anchor. Yeah, it kind of does. Yeah, it does. It has that shape. So you can work that symbol and take that as part of it. Again, I didn't know what he was going to draw. Anything else you see? Yes. Yeah, three trees could represent. There they are, right smack in the middle of the picture, right? Okay, yeah. You see hope, just hope coming out of the all of the symbols working together. Yeah. Well, we could go on with this, but now I want to shift the vision. And how does this thing apply to the vision we've been trying to communicate and create and hopefully is catching on with regard to this building project? What does that represent? When we describe what can go on there, what kind of visions do you see? I know the things that I see. Big. From the old to the new. Yeah. What do you see happening in this building? Pardon me? That God is looking upon us as we said about this thing. Patrice. A safe place for the community. Other vision pieces. Change. Change. A light in the darkness. I'm sorry. An open door. Hope for the community. People connecting in different ways. I've been sharing along the way here, not you were just stretching, not. I've been sharing along the way. What are the things that I see? I mean, I'm trying to be visual here, and connect with this lighthouse thing. How does the church serve as a lighthouse? And you can easily take that image, but in terms of the new building, what can happen in terms of it being a lighthouse? Last week, Patrice Hieronymus and Walt Reamer and I went and met with the principal at Dallas Town Elementary. Our purpose was to introduce him to what we're thinking about and to allow him to inform us what does he see in the community, what's happening with regard to the kids. I mean, actually, you know, we're practically on the same block, aren't we? And we can be quite a lighthouse to a certain population. I don't know if you know this or not, but over 50% of the children who attend Dallas Town are on the food program. What drives that? Poverty drives that. What's that mean in terms of the borough of Dallas Town? It doesn't mean that everybody's suffering like that, but it means that the significant population is. What does it mean to you to think of a kid who, when he gets out of school, probably won't see mom or dad until about 7 o'clock that night, or that mom or dad has to leave them in order to go to work? In order for them to get to school, they have to kind of rouse themselves about them and get there. What does that mean to you and to me? What does that mean for the possibility of the building? What's the kind of light that we can shine on that kind of situation? What does it mean to think of kids who would be invited to participate in a basketball program called Upward Bound that is catching fire in a lot of different places? You bring in volunteer people to coach and to referee, and then the kids come and they play basketball and learn the values of team and maybe get associated with one another as well as with people who care about them. And all of a sudden, someone's leading a devotional moment that they've never had before in their lives, and pretty quickly, you have a program that's making a lot of different kinds of waves than anything they've been at before. My son participated in the Dallas Town Cougars. I didn't see anybody pray at those games. In fact, I saw a lot of behavior that I wasn't necessarily pleased about with a couple of the coaches. And so what would that mean? What would that mean? How can Bethlehem Church be a beacon? Some people have questioned, well, what is the purpose of a coffee house? Why would a church put in a piece of architecture like that? Well, it's interesting, and this will be my last remark, because what I'm really trying to do is get you to visualize. I want you to look into this with your eyes and see things that you haven't seen before. When we mentioned the possibility of a coffee house to the architect, they pretty quickly, those of you who are on the steering committee team, they pretty quickly began to talk about this with a whole other vocabulary. They said, oh, you want to make a third space. A third space. We didn't know what they were talking. What's a third space? All we were talking about is having a coffee shop. And then they unpacked what it means to have a third space. And I need you to listen to this and be able to communicate it as you hear people questioning, what's that about? Third space is the kind of space that you create that allows people to enter into a moment of familiarity with your church and the programs of the church so that they are not threatened. Do you know how hard it is to go to church, especially if you're not a Christian, to go to church for the first time? Do you know how risky that is to go to church for the first time in a new building when you're not sure how they do things? It is not easy. Well, third space allows them to at least have a friend or two to connect with people, to maybe while their kids are there playing basketball, to look at what they're doing and look out across there and say, well, this isn't bad. This is kind of interesting. Or maybe to come at a time when the band is rehearsing and be able to look down into the gymnasium area and the worship space there, and suddenly they say, wow, kind of like that. And pretty quickly they're getting associated with programs and procedures that maybe would make them not so afraid anymore. Third space, it's an interesting concept, and I encourage you to think about it and to visualize who would come there. What is the last thing that you have seen built on Main Street in Dallas Town besides the bank, the new credit union going across the street? Just think about what that might mean to see new life on Main Street, Dallas Town, and to have that new life being brought out of the church. And it's a place where people can go and get their computer out and look at the Wi-Fi to connect with one another at all kinds of levels. In the meantime, we're going to have posters in there and communicate what we're trying to do, advertising preschool, summer camp, and all the rest. So we can do something with third space. And so I want you to visualize that and think one more thing about third space. This is the kind of space where you could have a young person from Dallas Town High School or Red Lion High School who's always wanted to get the guitar out and learn how to play in front of people. Learn how to play and get an audience so that they could perfect their act. And you would have that space available, and they could sit in the corner with a buddy or two and play and sing. And in the meantime, who's going to come to that? Friends. And what are they going to do? They're going to connect somehow or another. So third space is an interesting concept. It was not a concept we were familiar with until the architect told us. You can't do that everywhere. You can only do it on downtown churches. You can't, really is not the kind of a thing you can do out in the countryside. But on Main Street, you can do that. And I think that you'll find it to be an interesting thing. So vision, visualize. What do you see happening, and what can we make happen? Do we have all the ideas formulated? Of course not. Before and after school child care, according to Mr. Patterson, is a way to connect to basketball programs, volleyball programs, the third space concept of people getting familiar with who you are. Those are just some of the visions that I want to make sure that you're highlighting as you imagine what's going on here. So keep this in mind. How can we be a lighthouse to those who are around about us and keep that vision alive? I've asked Doris Krause to share a her story. It's not a story about money. It's a story about what this church has meant to her. And while she's doing this, I'd like maybe to have maybe one or two others just to think. And if you have a story you want to tell about what the church has meant to you, we'd be glad to hear it. I want a lot of them. I'd maybe be on to us. She's going to prime the pump, so to speak. And she's very anxious about this, by the way. But I told her, Taurus Krauss, you are one of the most highly respected figures in the whole of the congregation. How can you not say that? Do you want to do it sitting there, or do you want to stand here? Well, yeah, but you have to speak into the microphone. Now remember, this is a 4-inch microphone. You can't be down here. You have to be up here, so don't give us a lot of excuses to boo.
I was given the opportunity to share my testimony. So tonight, I would like to share that testimony with you, remembering my commitment to God, to Bethlehem Church, and to the New Vision Capital Campaign. So let's go back to 1993. My life has many dimensions. I'm a woman, wife, mother, grandmother, homemaker, secretary, and organist. My life is most interesting, but mostly very quite demanding. Sometimes a little frustrating, but mostly very, very fulfilling. One thing is certain in my life. All of these different dimensions would create chaos if it were not for the special focus that ties it all together. And that focus is the reality of Jesus Christ in my life. He is the center of my existence. He holds that prominence because at age 12, I gave my life to him. At age 13, I was asked to play for a morning worship service in a small church. I said yes, and continued to commit my weekends for serving the Lord in that way for over 45 years. It's now 66 years. I had a great deal of confidence in myself as a young person, even though I was shy, and still am, and usually managed to succeed in whatever I set my mind to do. My school years were great. I got married in 1956 and raised a family for 20 years when suddenly brokenness, a divorce, a parent with three young teenage boys. 3 years I struggled, searching and praying for that confidence I knew was there. Then I came to the deep realization I knew that Jesus Christ was there through it all, and he was still the living Savior in my daily life, and slowly he renewed that confidence in myself. And then I was introduced to Pastor Lou, who is my husband of 11 years, and all of my life dimensions have become deeper and richer. I continue to grow in our ministry and thank God every day for showing me the way. Life is fulfilling. And 22 years later, my life is still fulfilling here at Bethlehem Church. I am a widow with a caring family and now a great grandmother. I have friends, neighbors, etc. And I am the organist at Bethlehem Church, who is grounded in gratitude, prayer, and living in faith. God is so good. And now is the time. We are the people. God bless you all.
Thank you, Liz. Is there anyone else who perhaps has a story that they would like to share as a form of testimony? I know I'm doing this off the cuff, but sometimes those are the best. Yes, Betty. Now remember, this is a 4-inch microphone. And if you break into song, we'll join you.
I joined the church at 11 years. And after I graduated from high school, I went into nursing school, got married, and I was away from the church maybe 4 years. But I either a United Brethren or a United Methodist church. Well, the thing is, instead of nursing a lot, I had 5 children, and thank God, I had all of them. I stayed home most of the time raising them, and when I was 50, I went back to work at Downtown Family Practice and worked there for 12 years. I was taking care of Don, who had Parkinson's. I was his caregiver. In 2007, it was a really cold winter. I don't know how many of you remember the ice storm of that year. Well, I developed pneumonia. And it wasn't the ordinary pneumonia that we think about. It was BOOP. And not many people know what BOOP is. Well, they had to do a lung biopsy sent to the University of Pennsylvania, or Pittsburgh, in order to find out how to treat me. Dave took me to the doctor. And instead of going back home, I was shifted to the hospital. My temp was 95.7, and they piled warm blankets on me. Went to the intensive care. And while in the intensive care is when we had the terrible ice storm. Lo and behold, Carl walked from his house to the hospital to see me, threatening his own life in order to come to see me. Since then, I have been drawing for Judy, and I learned to draw 6 years ago. I had never drawn before, but we were sent to the Victorian Villa, and they organized an art class. And we went to Wrightsville and were told to sit at the picnic table and draw the bridge from Wrightsville to Columbia. And never having drawn, I managed to draw. But Don, he knew how to draw, but his hands didn't communicate. But that drawing is now hanging on the wall in Reno, Nevada, my daughter's. And we had classes one time a month, and there were about 6 of us would get together. I've continued drawing. The classes have disintegrated, but my family has provided me with blank note cards, and I've sent over 200. Some of you here at the church have gotten them, but I've sent to 19 states, to Argentina, to Germany, to Chile, to Alaska, which is a state, and I have not bought a card in all that time. So when I was in intensive care, I was on a respirator, and if any of you have ever been on a respirator, pray that you don't have to go on. because when they took me off, my daughter, who is a nurse in Reno, stood beside my bed and said, "Mom, you got to get better. You're a survivor." She said, "But this is going to be the worst part of your life, to try to breathe on your own." So that night, I know I looked at the clock every 5-10 minutes, praying that morning would come. And on the TV, there were pictures of nature, beautiful pictures, and songs, actually it was hymns, being played very silently. And I remember two of them: "Faith is a Victory," and "What Are You Doing the Rest of Your Life?" Well, I know now what I'm doing. I'm drawing for other people and giving them words of wisdom. So I'm thanking God that I'm here, and I know He has His hand in mine, or I would not be able to draw.
I've been the beneficiary of a number of those cards. I keep one in my Bible that she did most recently as kind of a bookmark. And she's always very gracious. If I ever go to a nursing home, I want to be like Betty Raver. I want to be her. I want to be like you. What an attitude. And she has this way of, she sends a card to every new resident in the Victorian building when they get there. And she shares the wisdom that if they just calm down and give themselves to the place, everything will be all right. One more? Yes, Patricia.
A thought came to me that adults need role models too. And my family and I came to this church about 11 years ago. We visited the contemporary service, and John Padahovich welcomed us there, and we knew people from Scout. And if it weren't for other families that we met here, I can be a real negative person, and I'm a real worrier. And the people that I've met here shared with me their situations with their children, their teenagers, their college-age children, and even now I have young adult sons, and people share with me their experiences. It's so helpful to me. I don't know what I would do without that. And it's not like I have a million close friends. It's just like these experiences all the time of people telling me how they handle the situation that I'm facing, and it's just a very wonderful thing. I'm very grateful to have found this place. It's been really helpful in my life.
Many of you have spoken about the power of the cardboard testimonies, and we've had more of a run on those, that particular DVD worship service, than any other single one that we've ever done. And I think it's because of these kinds of testimonies that just, you know, they're out there. And everyone has met God along the way in some way or another. And thanks be to God, and thanks be to Christ for the gift of faith that He's given to us. I'm going to ask the people who agreed to hold up numbers if they'll go up here. And Vanna, will you pass out yes, you, Catherine. It's all random. Just give them a card, and then they can go up here and stand in front of the picture. Up on the stage, this is big. We're not fooling around. Up on the stage. if you're doing the prices right, the person, somebody, and it doesn't matter who it is, and in fact, it might take two or three people by the time we get this right, but somebody needs to come up here and do the organizing. Oh, yeah, we need to. Well, we know where the comma goes, so you're all right, John. We just get yourself where you think the comma should be. This is the first test. Oh, great. Okay, now who would like to be the person trying to arrange this? So, what we're trying to do is have you arrange this according to the number where you think we are right now. Anybody want to do that? Do I have to? Oh, thank you, Melinda. And Georgia, since it's your birthday, please go up and be the next one in line in case Melinda can't get it done. Be ready, Georgia.
I'm optimistic.
Yes. You think that's it? 968,179. Now we have a bell ringer in the audience. Three of these numbers are correct. Three of these numbers are correct. So we need to, and you're in the audience. You know what happens if the price is right? People start screaming about where should you put these numbers? And so what changes do you need to make in order to make this? Yes, you need, no, you get three chances. And then Georgia gets three, and we'll laugh at her, too.
Help her out, audience. Help her out.
Evan, let's have you
Evan.
Where should Evan go? Second or third?
Third.
No, he doesn't. He doesn't know much about anything. He's from Alabama. Let's hear the bell. This means three are still wrong. Three are still wrong. Come on, audience, help her out. Let's okay, well, the audience is laughing, but you've been of no help. So, Georgia, let's have a round of it.
So the nine has to go first.
Yeah.
968.
Interesting, Jim, your husband. You're doing well, George. Take your time. Last chance. This is the last one. Any more bold maneuvers up here? Anybody think they know? It's a confusing set of numbers. Switch to 7 and 9. Switch to 7 and 9. That's... Let's go with that suggestion. Switch to 7 and 9, because I know they haven't moved for a little bit. Okay, here we go. Now, I don't know if anybody brought their pledge card with them tonight, but we could get to a million. We could get to a million very soon. This represents the efforts of 61 families who have stepped forward to turn in a card. 61 families who have said that this is something they believe in, to the extent that they're willing to go this far in order to make this happen. So I don't know how you feel about that. I find it rather remarkable. And all of this is very humbling as a pastor, because there are two things going on here. One is a leadership of a congregation that energized and energized and energized, along with the guidance of a wise counselor that has been through this over 200 times. He says, I don't know if he'll believe him or not, but Scott McKenzie has done very well with us and guided us along the way. And then, of course, the people who have said yes to the campaign. Almost a million. I suspect that tomorrow we'll get there. I really believe tomorrow we'll get there as people bring in their cards. The last thing I wanted to do this evening is everyone in the congregation. Thank you. Thank you very much. You've been very patient with us. Yeah, the comma made it, John. The comma made it. Everyone in the congregation, except those who pledged, when did we put that mailing together, the most recent mailing? Friday? It went out Tuesday, but it was put together Thursday of the week prior. So we're a week and a half from the time when the latest mailing was assembled. So if you had turned in a card before the mailing was assembled, you would not have received this because your name was pulled. However, if you, in between now and then, if you have received this in the mail and have turned in a pledge card, you don't need to turn one in again. Please know that. But this is the card that you received in the mail. And I just want you to know that between now and then, we're asking you to pray. We're asking you again to pray. Pray what it is that God is calling you to do as you determine the answer to the prayer. What does God want to do through you? And as we celebrate this possibility this evening and this number already, I would remind you, I think, of two things. First of all, a church needs to pull together to accomplish something like we're talking about. This is not something anyone does alone. And we need all gifts of any denomination, gifts large, gifts small. Those all are worthy of what we're trying to accomplish as we move ahead. So be aware of that. The other thing just slipped my mind. Be aware of the pledge card, and our desire is that on June the 7th, everyone who has not submitted a card after taking the week from now until that day, that everyone will make an effort to fill out a card and bring it as we dedicate all of these cards to the glory of God as part of our worship services on that day. So that's the goal. That's our desire. So here's the card. All have received it. If you haven't received one or feel as though you need to have one, they're here. We'll be glad to give them to you. We'll have them available tomorrow. And so be prayerful. Be prayerful about what is going on with regard to the church. Oh, the other thing I wanted to say is it was very interesting for me to learn that Scott McKenzie, his observation is that only 2% of the churches in the United States of America can raise 3 times their budget. Only 2%. We are not at the 2% yet, but I am so optimistic because we have almost reached 2/3. We've already reached twice our budget. And so what's to prevent us from moving ahead and perhaps tripling our budget and being numbered among the 2%? It's a good challenge. It's an interesting challenge. One I hope that we'll take up. That's the information I wanted to share with you. And I won't belabor it anymore, except to say thank you. Thank you for being here. Come and take a good look at the picture. Come and be ready for worship tomorrow as we share what it means to live sacrificially. These series of sermons have been prescribed. They're my sermons, but they've been prescribed in their themes by Scott McKenzie, and there's a method to the progression that we've had, and the next one is tomorrow, sacrifice. What does it mean to sacrifice? Let us pray. Almighty God, for some of us, it's been a sacrifice to simply come and enjoy the evening. For others, it's been nothing but a great, great joy to share together and to laugh together and to think about you, how you touch our lives. We don't want to make the mistake of minimizing that you are in our midst. The Holy Spirit is at work, and we continue to try to follow after the work of that Holy Spirit. Because the Spirit's work becomes our work as we follow Christ. Bless us as we make our way home. Thank you for the richness of the evening and especially for the wonderful people who gave their time to prepare the food and who have given themselves so richly to all of us. Bless us and keep us. And may we continue to breed a prayerful people. In Christ we pray. Amen. Thank you again all for coming. How about two things? Let's just sing two things. First, let's sing Happy Birthday to Georgia Hunt.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Georgia. Happy birthday to you.
She wants to say something. Is this okay, Jim?
The traditional Memorial Day. So as a kid, we always had a big family picnic. So I thought it was all for me. So, but this is the biggest one yet.
Well, it's nice of you to wear a blouse that matched the tablecloth. That was nice. The last one is, let's sing Amazing Grace. Let's stand to do that. You've been sitting so long.
Amazing.